Cool. Well, perhaps we can go ahead and get started if that's all right with you.
Okay, that sounds good.
Cool. Just got a little intro for you. All right, welcome back to the Pacific Northwest Aerospace Expo. This is Alfonso Gonzalez with us here today. Alfonso Gonzalez is a Space Mission Design Analyst at Nabla Zero Labs, where he works on deep space trajectory design, software engineering, and mission visualizations using NASA's SPICE-enhanced Cosmographia. He graduated from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo in 2020 with a Bachelor's of Science in Aerospace Engineering, concentrating on astronautics. Throughout that time in school, Alfonso worked 6 internships and was a member of the Cal Poly CubeSat Research Lab. At his 3 internships at Planetary Resources, Alfonso worked on 1 asteroid and 2 low Earth orbit missions, where his roles included the modeling and simulation of asteroid ejecta trajectories, interplanetary trajectories, attitude determination and control systems, or ADCS for short, or simulations for those, and infrared instrument characterization and testing. At GomSpace Luxembourg, Alfonso worked on 2 asteroid missions contracted by ESA, or the European Space Agency, where his responsibilities covered proximity operations, solar electric propulsion, or SEP system modeling, and Earth-Moon flyby trajectories. Alfonso has quite the resume. Alfonso will be presenting gravity assist trajectory design to explore our solar system and beyond, which will cover the astrodynamics, numerical methods, and software engineering behind calculating gravity assist trajectories. Alfonso, thank you for your time. If you'd like to take it away.
All right, thank you for the intro. Let me see if I can share my screen. Does that look right?
So. Sure does.
Okay. Yeah, so as you've seen from the title of this talk, this is going to be about gravity assist trajectory design, which is basically any spacecraft that you heard of going to deep space, like the Voyagers, OSIRIS-REx, Europa Clipper, Juno. All of them use flybys of the planets, specifically more so the inner planets. Only Voyager has really gone out to the outside in order to gain velocity out there without using fuel. So kind of just using the dynamics of the solar system in order to increase the velocity and then reach the outer planets. Again, when you take away that fuel mass that you use with gravity assist, you can add more mass for, say, your instruments to do more science on board. So this video here is just showing kind of a bunch of different gravity assist trajectories that have already happened just across the industry. So like OSIRIS-REx, there are the Voyager trajectories over here. There's New Horizons, who didn't really use any, but just went straight to Pluto, which is a pretty interesting trajectory. And then later in this talk, we'll also be showing Lucy, which launched, I think last weekend, if that's correct, and then Europa Clipper as well, the 2 proposed trajectories for Europa Clipper. So this talk is going to be broken down into basically 4 sections. So starting off with the fundamentals of orbital mechanics and what is a gravity assist. Basically, it's a hyperbolic flyby of a planet. And then how are increases in heliocentric velocity possible? So gaining velocity with respect to the sun, given that conservation of energy and angular momentum are conserved. And then we'll get into how to actually calculate these gravity turn or gravity assist trajectories using V-infinity matching. And then later on, we'll get into a bit of higher level using graph theory of how to solve this problem using a large scalar solar system tree, basically trying every single combination of gravity assist across the whole solar system in order to fulfill whatever mission requirements that you have. So starting with the fundamentals of orbital mechanics, we have to start with a two-body problem, where in the two-body problem, you assume that all that exists in your universe are 2 bodies, where one is really large, like the Earth, and the other is small, like a spacecraft around the Earth, which is shown in the diagram here, where the purple is the orbit of the spacecraft. And in this problem, we assume that the central body is spherical and its mass is evenly distributed. And when you assume that, you can assume that the center of mass is coming at the geometric center, which is shown here at the center of the 3 vectors. And we also assume that the large body influences the small body gravitationally, as we can see by the orbit, but the small body does not influence the large body, which is a good assumption because something like a spacecraft is not going to change the orbit of something so big like the Earth. And then we also assume we have a reference frame that is inertial and it's centered at the central body geometric center. So again, these white arrows represent the inertial frame in this case. And we assume the central body is stationary and that reference frame is fixed at that center. And then from this, from all these assumptions, we get Newton's universal law of gravitation, which at the end of it states that the force due to gravity, or the acceleration due to gravity, is a 1/r² relationship, where r is a distance between the center of the inertial frame and the center of the central body to wherever the spacecraft is at any given time, where r here is the position vector. And we get this equation from Newton's universal law of gravitation, which is in a scalar form, that the force due to gravity is equal to g, which is a gravitational constant in our universe, the mass of the small body, which is a spacecraft, the mass of a large body, which is the Earth, over the distance between them squared. And then we use Newton's second law, which most people know as F equals ma, but his law is actually that the net force on an object is due to the time derivative of momentum with respect to time. And this is linear momentum, where linear momentum is equal to mass times velocity, where in this case, we can assume the mass of the spacecraft is constant, so that gets taken out of the derivative, which then equals to mass times derivative of velocity with respect to time, which is acceleration, which is where you get F equals ma. So if you put these two equations equal to each other, you see that the mass of the small object cancels out, which leaves us with the most fundamental equation in orbital mechanics in the scalar form, which is that the acceleration of the small body in this orbit is equal to g, which is, again, the universal or the gravitational constant in our universe, times the mass of the large body over the distance between them squared. And in our universe, this g is constant. The mass of the Earth is relatively constant. So you can group those two numbers together to make a mu value for the Earth or any large body that you want to use, that you want to simulate. And that there is the most fundamental equation in the most like succinct form, which is the mu over r squared. And then if we move that into a vector, because this is a scalar value, this is just a number. If we want to move this into vectors, into actually how we simulate these, we have to add a negative sign, because the acceleration due to gravity is in the exact opposite direction of the position of the spacecraft. So if the vector is pointing of the position from the center to the spacecraft here, acceleration is exactly in the opposite direction. We multiply it by the vector and then divide by the magnitude cubed, because 1 magnitude over 3 magnitudes is 1/r². And then from this as well, Newton's universal law of gravitation and the 1/r² relationship, we get that all orbits are conic sections in the two-body problem, and they are symmetrical about their apse line. So the apse line is this dashed line here, which points from the center of the central body to the periapsis point, where periapsis is just the point that is closest in the orbit to the central body. And because gravity is a conservative force, and that's the only force acting onto the spacecraft, energy and angular momentum are conserved. And they're a little bit differently defined. We'll go over the specific mechanical energy. But basically, you can think of this specific mechanical energy as, if you remember, like in high school physics, you go kinetic energy is 1/2 mv², but here we just remove the m from that. And then the gravitational potential energy is a little bit different, because the gravitational constant of the central body mu has some weird units. So we just do it like this, and we'll go further into this definition in a few more slides. And then we get that the angular momentum in its vector form is equal to the cross product between the position and the velocity vector. And this also means that the angular momentum vector is pointed perpendicular to the orbital plane, and that is constant. So in the two body problem, the orbital plane will always be fixed constant in inertial space. And then the magnitude of the angular momentum is the magnitude of the position times the magnitude of the velocity vector times the sine of the angle between them. And that is the definition of a cross product. And in this case, planetary flybys, which are what we're going to be talking about, gravity assist, are hyperbolic orbits where the eccentricity is greater than one. So now we get to that there's an inverse relationship because of the second derivative. I forgot to mention that. That acceleration here is a second derivative of position. So this here is a differential equation where there's position. The first derivative of position is velocity. And then the derivative of velocity is acceleration. So that's the second derivative. And acceleration and velocity have inverse relationships in this problem. So we can see on the top right, what we're showing here is the is an elliptical orbit around the Earth. And here is the states with respect to time. So on the top here is a position in all three axes. So the red is a position in the X, the green is position in the Y, and the blue is position in the Z, which is just zero because we just chose this to be planar. And then the purple is a norm. So basically the magnitude, the magnitude of the position vector at any single time. And the same thing with the velocity on the bottom. So the red is X, the green is Y. And then the magnitude is in purple. And then we can see that inverse relationship. So as position, it's at its minimum here, velocity is at its maximum. And the same thing over here, that when position is at its maximum, velocity is at its minimum. And then here just we have the same relationships again. And this is why these values are constant, because as the magnitude of position is increasing, the magnitude of the velocity is decreasing. And then this, there's an angle in there. So like, or angular momentum is a little bit different to look at in this diagram since it's a cross product. But for the magnitude of the mechanical energy, we can see that as the magnitude of the velocity increases, the magnitude of the position decreases, which makes these values constant throughout the entire orbit. So then specific mechanical energy is, as I said earlier, defined a little bit different in astrodynamics because it's meant to show how bound you are to a central body. So if you remember from, again, high school physics, the total energy of an object is the potential plus the kinetic, which is the kinetic is 1/2 mv². The potential is like mgh. But here we define it as kinetic minus potential, because what this is saying is that when you're total mechanical energy is negative, it means that your potential energy is greater than your kinetic energy, which means that you're bound to the planet. So if it's around Earth, that means you're in an elliptical orbit, you're not going to escape Earth. But then once eccentricity hits one here, which means a parabolic orbit, you have just enough kinetic energy that matches the potential energy that you have with respect to the Earth. So at that point, you're no longer bound by Earth's gravity and you will continue to go on an infinite distance away. Obviously, that doesn't exist in real life, but for the two-body problem, you will go an infinite distance away. And then anything above that is just excess energy that you have on top. So once your mechanical energy is positive, you just have a lot more energy than your potential. So you're no longer bound by Earth and you'll just keep going on to infinity. And I should mention again that this is going to be important later on, that the specific mechanical energy is proportional. That's a proportional sign to the semi-major axis, where the semi-major axis is basically just a measure of how large an orbit is. And it's just in units of kilometers. That's all you have to know. But eventually you'll get to later on where these gravity assists, they increase your velocity, which therefore increase your semi-major axis, which lets you reach the planets that are farther out in the solar system. So interplanetary flyby, what they are is they're hyperbolic trajectories with respect to the planet that they're flying by. So in this case, we have Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. Voyager 2 is what we're going to be taking a look at in a lot of these slides, in the Voyager 2 flyby of Jupiter. So in here on the bottom right, we have that flyby zoomed in where where Voyager 2 is initially coming in from here and then doing a flyby and exiting in that direction. And here is, again, that velocity plot with respect to time during the flyby. So again, red is the x-axis velocity, green is the y-axis velocity, and blue is the z-axis velocity. And then the magnitude of the velocity is the purple. So basically what happens in a flyby event, it's a hyperbolic trajectory. So the velocity vector is rotated. So as Voyager 2 is coming in, it has a velocity vector coming in this direction, which is mostly in the y direction in this frame, which we can see from here, the green, this is most of the magnitude of the velocity vector is coming in the y. But then after doing the flyby, that velocity vector is rotated. So when this Voyager 2 is exiting Jupiter's sphere of influence, most of the velocity is in the negative x direction, which we can see in the plot here as well. So basically that's what's happening in a flyby. All you're doing is that you're coming in with some velocity vector and you're going out with the same magnitude of velocity, but your vector is going to be rotated with respect to the planet that you're flying by, which is Jupiter. And it's really important to note here that the magnitude of the velocity does not increase with respect to the flyby planet. So I just really want to emphasize this because this is really important, that with respect to Jupiter, Voyager 2 did not gain any velocity by doing this flyby. All it did was just rotate it with respect to Jupiter. So when you just rotate a velocity vector, that changes your angular momentum, but it does not change your heliocentric energy or your specific mechanical energy. So if we take a look again at the angular momentum equation, where angular momentum is a cross product between the position and velocity, you'll see that if you rotate that velocity vector, that will change the magnitude of the angular momentum because the magnitude of it is dependent on the sine of the angle between those two vectors. So if we take a look at the plot on the right, they both have the same position vector right here, but they have velocities that are rotated from each other. If I remember correctly, this is like 20 or 25 degrees that are rotated from each other. And we can see that they're really different orbits. So basically this blue or cyan one is pretty elliptical, but then when its velocity vector is rotated towards the position vector, it becomes more circular. And this is important because it matters which way your velocity vector is being rotated. But since the velocity vector is only rotated and they have the same position vector, the specific mechanical energy doesn't change because the magnitudes didn't change. Again, when you're talking about a pure rotation of a velocity vector, the magnitude remains equal. Therefore, this whole equation remains constant. But as we know from flybys, we can see that the planets are reaching outer, or the spacecraft that are doing these gravity assists are reaching outer and outer planets like Jupiter, Neptune, Uranus. So there has to be some way in order for this actual velocity to increase and not just rotate, because as we see here, rotating is not enough to actually reach the outer planets. So here we have to figure out why that is possible, that these spacecraft are actually gaining heliocentric velocity. When I say heliocentric, that means with respect to the sun. And this is because, as we said in the two-body problem, that the velocity is with respect to the central body, where the central body is stationary in the inertial frame, as we can see here. But in reality, that's not actually true, because when you fly by Jupiter, Jupiter itself is in an orbit around the sun. So that's how we could use that to gain velocity. So basically, we have this equation here that says Voyager 2's velocity vector with respect to the sun is equal to its velocity vector with respect to Jupiter, which is what we've been seeing, but then plus the velocity vector of Jupiter. So this is a really big thing that we do. So if we zoom in on this little section right here, which is a Voyager 2 flyby of Jupiter, there's a really fuzzy image right there of that zoomed in. Voyager 2 arrives with this velocity vector here. It's just some velocity vector that it's arriving with. And then we can see that there's a discontinuity, which is the gravity assist that rotates Voyager 2's velocity vector and actually increases its magnitude. So that's this vector. This vector is Jupiter's velocity vector at this specific time that is pointed in this direction. And then this green vector is the delta V vector. So basically how much will the rotation and the magnitude that Voyager 2 gained by doing the flyby of Jupiter. So what we can see here is that this green velocity vector is just it's the distance between the arrival velocity vector there to there. So that's exactly the same vector. It's just centered over here. And in order to reconcile like why this is allowed, why this aligns with the conservation of specific mechanical energy, is because of the fact that we can see the distance between the Jupiter velocity vector and the arrival velocity vector, this vector right here, its magnitude is equal to Jupiter's velocity vector and the departing velocity vector, its magnitude right there. It's just rotated from each other. And that's kind of what is going on in a gravity assist, is that because the velocity vector is being rotated towards the Jupiter vector, in order for that magnitude to remain constant between the arrival and the departure, this velocity vector actually has to increase in order for the distance from this vector to be the same as a distance to that vector. And again, with that rotation. So that's kind of, hopefully that explains well the intuition behind how you can gain heliocentric velocity with these flybys, is that the velocity vectors are rotated towards the planet velocity vectors. Therefore, they have to increase in order to remain the same magnitude before that. So before that and after that. Hopefully that was not too bad of an explanation of how that works. So then once we have the intuition down, then we can start doing what's called zero sphere of influence, V infinity matching, which is how you actually calculate these gravity assist trajectories. So when we do this, for a background, this is an example trajectory of Earth, Venus, Mars, Earth trajectory. So EVME, where the spacecraft starts here at Earth, leaves Earth, does a flyby of Venus right here, gets all the way out to Mars over here, does a flyby of Mars, and then comes back to Earth over here. So when we do this type of calculation, we assume that the flyby planets have zero sphere of influence. And what that means is that when you arrive at the planet, so when the spacecraft is going from Earth to Venus, it arrives at Venus with some velocity vector. And then at the next time step, it has the same position vector, but a new velocity vector that is a result of the gravity assist. And we do this because it's actually a really good assumption, at least for first order analysis, because the amount of time that a spacecraft will spend within the sphere of influence of a planet is on the order of a day, whereas the whole trajectory is on the order of years. So it's a very small amount. So this is a good first order analysis and can be used as an initial iterate in order to refine the trajectory later on. So basically what this is what's called a patch conics method, where these are elliptical heliocentric orbits. So elliptical orbits with respect to the sun that are patched at each gravity assist. So initially we have some orbit here with respect to the sun. Then once we hit Venus, we have a new orbit with respect to the sun. Once we hit Mars, we have a new orbit with respect to the sun. And that's called patch conics. And then I use the term V-infinity, but I didn't really explain it that well. So the definition of the V-infinity vector or the V-infinity magnitude is the velocity of a spacecraft once it reaches an infinite distance away from the planet. So this is going back to the two-body problem, because when you just have your spacecraft in the central body and you have more kinetic energy than you are bound by the potential energy, you're going to reach an infinite distance away. And then basically, this is a theoretical value, of course, but then once you reach an infinite distance away from the body, you're still going to have some amount of velocity because you have more kinetic energy than potential. And that is a definition of V infinity. And this is also a vector, which again, that's the scalar form of how you like to think about it. But then we can also apply this in a vector sense, which also has a direction. So since we're assuming zero sphere of influence for these planets, the actual V infinity is just whatever velocity the spacecraft has at that point, and then minus the velocity of the planet that it has at that point. So, and then both of those are with respect to the sun. So this is going to be really useful for a lot of things, just calculating the V infinity vectors. If we assume that the spacecraft has no sphere of influence, it's just straightforward, just calculating it like this. So the most important part into doing this type of analysis is Lambert's problem, which is a boundary value problem. So Lambert's problem states that if you have two position vectors and a time between them, and you know what your central body is, you can calculate the velocity vectors at each of those position vectors given the two-body problem. So this is super useful for, say, calculating a trajectory from Earth to Mars, because on the right here, we have here the spacecraft starts at Earth. So we have some position vector that is Earth. And then at some point in the future, we have a position vector that is Mars, which is a definition of a Lambert's problem. And then we define how much time do we want to take between getting from Earth to Mars. And with a Lambert solver, you can actually calculate that entire trajectory assuming two-body dynamics, because what Lambert gives you is that you have this position vector. Lambert's problem will give you a velocity vector. And then once you reach Mars, it'll give you another velocity vector of what your velocity is once you reach there. And these methods, the Lambert solvers, are solved using shooting methods, which, if you're not familiar with shooting methods, it's basically a numerical way of finding a solution to a problem where there might not be an analytical solution. So it's basically saying in this Lambert's problem, you can think about it as guess some initial velocity vector, propagate that for a certain amount of time, and see how close it is to where Mars is at that final amount of time. And there's going to be some error. So then shooting methods, what they do is they use the error from the actual true solution that they want, and they use that to estimate the initial guess at what the initial boundary should be in order to converge on that value. And then shooting methods in general, if they're good, will converge, and then you can get solutions like this numerically. And since Lambert's problem gives us these velocity vectors of the spacecraft when you're at Earth and then when you're reaching Mars, we can use that to calculate the V infinity vector, which is going to be really important. So Lambert's problem is going to give you a velocity vector here, and you plug that in here as V spacecraft minus V planet, which is going to be the velocity of Earth with respect to the sun at this point. And you have your V infinity, and then the same thing over here. And it's worth noting that Lambert's problem has a lot of different types of solvers, and there's a lot of solutions to Lambert's problem. Specifically, for this type of Lambert solver that is being shown here, these are two different solutions for calculating a trajectory to Mars, where here we can see this is kind of known as a short way. So the orbit here changes in true anomaly, basically how far it goes around in its arc. It's less than 180 degrees. And here's an example of where it goes over 180 degrees along its arc to get to Mars. So it's worth noting that there's multiple solutions to Lambert's problem. Lambert's problem is just a problem, and there's many different types of solvers that solve Lambert's problem for different things. So planetary ephemeris, which is basically the position and velocity vectors of planets with respect to time, and how we're going to get those is really important, because we need to know, obviously, where is Earth, where is Mars, where is Jupiter with respect to time when we want to plan these trajectories. And those are given by SPICE kernels, where SPICE is this whole system of kernels, which is a bunch of data that's based on spacecraft trajectory, planetary trajectories, mass, reference frames, attitude, everything like that. It's basically just the system that JPL has in order to publish all this data. And then they also have a software kit that goes along with that data that's really good at reading it and does a bunch of other different types of calculations, like what is a, if you have a position vector in one reference frame, what is that position vector in another reference frame? You can use the SPICE software in order to do that. And they publish what's called these developmental ephemeris data sets, where they update them for missions if they need them. For example, when New Horizons went to Pluto, they uploaded a different developmental ephemeris file in order to actually kind of account for the better data that they had for Pluto as they were going out there. Basically, how you save this trajectory data is by Chebyshev polynomials in between the data points. So basically, say you have this trajectory of Voyager 2 with respect to Jupiter. I mean, computers only have a finite amount of memory, so you can't just store, say, 10 million different data points that describe the entirety of this trajectory. And this is only with respect to Jupiter. Think about the over, 50 years now that Voyager's been flying. You can't really store that amount of data in a reasonable amount of space. So what you do is you discretize. So basically, you take a bunch of points. Say for this Jupiter trajectory, say you split it up to 100 points. And then if you want to find the Voyager 2 trajectory data, the position and velocity with respect to Jupiter in between one of the points that you actually saved, you use interpolation in between them using what's called Chebyshev polynomials. And the Chebyshev part of it isn't that important. Just know that they're using higher order polynomials. So say a fifth order polynomial to estimate or to interpolate what the position and velocity would be in between the data points that you actually saved. And this here is just general equations for them. So basically save them by position in the X, position in the Y, position Z, velocity X, velocity Y, velocity C, and they save them like that. And you can have them as arbitrarily large as you want. That just depends on your application. So you can have a ninth order polynomial, or you can have, say, a third or fourth or fifth order polynomial. So basically that's how you store the ephemeris, which is the position and velocity of the planets. And also once you're done with your trajectory, it's usually good practice to just save them as a SPICE kernel. So once we have all that, there's a lot of information there. We can start to set up this V-infinity matching problem, which actually calculates the gravity assist. So basically what we're doing is we're solving Lemmer's problems in sequence. So we're gonna use the example trajectory that's an EVME. So Earth, Venus, Mars, Earth trajectory. So what it's doing here is it's starting this blue position vector is pointing at the Earth at the initial time. And the spacecraft is going to go from the Earth, arc around and do a flyby of Venus. And then after that flyby of Venus, it's going to go around and do a flyby of Mars over here. So when you're setting up this problem, this initial arc, the first arc from Earth to Venus is going to be a given. This V infinity matching is not solving for that. You're telling the V-infinity matcher, here's a trajectory that's coming into Venus, and the V-infinity matcher is going to calculate the trajectory from Venus to Mars. That's a job of the V-infinity matcher. So basically what this does is you have some V-infinity that's coming into Venus, and we know it's V-infinity with respect to Venus. We know that before and after the flyby, the magnitude of the V-infinities have to be equal with respect to Venus. But they can be different with respect to the sun, but they have to be equal with respect to Venus in order to be a gravity assist. So what we have when we have these constraints is a scalar valued single variable function that describes what we're looking for. So basically we have this delta V infinity, which is the difference in V infinity from going in and coming out, the magnitude of that is equal to the V infinity arriving, the magnitude of that, minus the magnitude of the V infinity when you're departing. And we want that to equal to zero. That's a definition of V infinity matching. But we don't necessarily know how to calculate that initially. So what we do is we use a Lambert's problem, because as we said before, Lambert's problem, what it does is given two position vectors and a time of flight in between them, it'll calculate the velocity vectors at those positions. But here we don't know what the time of flight is going to be to get to Mars in order for those V infinities to be matched. And that's what we're solving for. And we do it iteratively. So basically what this is saying is that we have some V infinity coming in. We're going to use Lambert's problem. We're going to guess a time of flight that'll reach Mars. Lambert's problem will give us some sort of solution that'll say in 100 days, if you want to reach Mars from Venus, or if you want to go from Venus to Mars in 100 days, Lambert's problem is going to give you a solution, but that doesn't mean that the V infinities are matched. So basically you use that initial guess at a time of flight, say 100 days, and then use information about the dynamics of the system in order to update your guess. Because say, if you guess here on the plot 100 days, the difference between the V infinities in this case is gonna be around like 1.8 kilometers per second, which means that you didn't actually solve the problem. And what and how you're going to solve this is using basically a Newton method of root solving. So basically what root solvers do is they find the input variable such that the output is going to be equal to zero. And that's what we want here. The input variable is the time of flight, and we want this equation to be equal to zero. And you also need the derivative information of this function in order to get that, because as we said, say we plug in 100 days for the time of flight, it gives us a delta V infinity of say negative 1.8. What we can do is that function evaluated here, if we know its derivative, which we can calculate, we can follow its derivative, which is a tangent line at this plot. We can follow that derivative all the way until it hits zero and say that's at x equals time of flight 120 days. We can use this as the new guess of what our time of flight should be. So now we'll plug in 120 days, and this is done systematically with the computer. You plug in 120 days, we get that the delta V infinity is equal to say negative 0.5. Then we use the derivative again. We follow the derivative, which is a tangent line that gets us really close to what the solution is when this function equals to zero. Say that's like 135 days. And we can do that again and again. Even though it's really close, you can always get closer and closer. And eventually this will converge on a value, and you just have to decide when you're happy with your solution. So basically it could be, say, I want to know within one day what this V infinity will be, and then you can solve that. Or you can say, you know, I want to know up to 1 second of when this V infinity matching should be, and you can do that as well. So basically what this is doing, the whole problem of this is finding this root solver problem to this equation. It's a scalar valued single variable equation. Find the root of that function using a Newton's method. But here, there's a lot of cases where you don't want to take the derivative of a function because it's actually really complicated. Even though this function looks really simple, the V infinity of how we get these velocity vectors is really not simple and involves a shooting method, which is a numerical method, which you don't really want to take the derivative of because it could be a huge pain. It could take you hours to do. Whereas if you, or maybe even more than hours, where you can actually just estimate your derivative using finite differences, where this goes back to kind of how high school level calculus, where you know that the derivative of a function is equal to the change in y over the change in x. And then when you take the derivative, you take the limit as that change in x approaches zero, where when you have computers, you can just make that change in x be almost equal to zero. Well, you can make it equal to say 1 to the -9, and that's basically your derivative. And that's what we can use here. So we don't even have to know the derivative of the function as an analytical solution. We can just estimate it using finite differences, use Newton's method to converge it, and find our answer to the V infinity problem. So I hope that was clear. Let me know if you have questions, because that was kind of a lot of information in one slide, but that's kind of the gist of how you do this. And then the next part is doing the next part of the trajectory, which again, since this function is actually a really complicated function, we don't actually know how it's going to be shaped. So from the last one, it looked like this. And then for this part of the trajectory, it looks like this. So we don't know. And we also don't need to know, because we have this method of estimating the derivative, and we just evaluate the function. We don't really care what it looks like as long as this Newton solver is going to converge on the root of it. So in this case, we're going from Mars back to Earth, as we said, EVME trajectory. And again, it's just doing the same thing. We have some V infinity coming in from the Venus flyby getting to Mars. And we need to find out how much time is it going to take to get back to Earth to solve Lambert's problem in order for those V infinity vectors coming in from Mars and going out of Mars to be equal to each other. And that's represented by this function here. And again, just use Newton's method, converge on the zero, and you have your answer. But it's worth noting that you're not always, I said you don't care how it looks. It's kind of true, because in Newton's methods or in root solving methods in general, it depends what your initial guess is at the time of flight, because this function could behave very differently when you use another Lambert solver, for example, where you can do multiple revolutions. So there's multiple revolutions Lambert solvers, which say we'll go from Mars, do one complete orbit of the sun, and then on the second orbit converge down to Earth. So it really depends on your Lambert solver and how the dynamics work of your solver and the system in order to converge on the right solution. So last weekend, Lucy launched. For those who are space fans or keep up with that, it's a pretty cool launch. It's got a really cool trajectory, and it's basically using 3 Earth gravity assists to get out to the launch points of the Sun-Jupiter system. So on the left, so what it's doing 2 flybys of Earth initially, and after the second flyby of Earth, it's going to go all the way out to L4. and then it's going to come back towards the Earth, do an inclination change, and then go out to L5 to visit another asteroid system called Patroclus. So on the left is that trajectory in the inertial frame. Again, this one is just called EEE, so Earth, 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 gravity trajectories. I mean, gravity assist trajectories, but you could also count, they're doing a lot of trajectory correction maneuvers in deep space. You can probably also count those, but in general, that's what Lucy's doing. And then here is that, here's the trajectory in the Sun-Jupiter rotating frame, which if you've been keeping up with Lucy, and if you've seen kind of posts on LinkedIn or Twitter or anything like that, you've probably seen this trajectory more, which is a trajectory as it looks in the Sun-Jupiter rotating frame, but it's not an inertial frame. So that's not, you have to keep in mind that this isn't actually what the dynamics look like when you model it in an inertial frame. The Sun-Jupiter rotating frame is a frame that's defined as the x-axis is pointing from the Sun to Jupiter, so that's constant. And the z-axis is pointing in the angular momentum direction of the Jupiter's orbit. So it's the cross product of Jupiter's position and velocity, which is kind of perpendicular. So it's coming out of the screen. And the third axis just completes a right-handed system. So x cross y equals v. Yeah, so note that if you see this Lucy trajectory out there, that it's in a Sun-Jupiter rotating frame, it's not in an inertial frame. But it's still interesting to look at because this is how, this is kind of how you look at Lagrange points and how they're defined in a three-body problem. That's the reference frame of the three-body problem. So it makes sense sometimes to look at it like that, but just know the difference between the two. So we're just going to real quick go through Lucy's Earth gravity assist. So the first one, it's launching from Earth. So right now it's probably like around here since it's only been a week. It's going to do a 1-year trajectory around the Sun, and it's going to come back and fly by Earth basically at the same place. So it's doing its first Earth gravity assist basically 1 year after its launch last weekend. So from this, we can know that Lucy's velocity vector with respect to the Sun was just rotated because, so basically that usually means a C3 equal to zero. So basically Lucy just escaped Earth's gravity because its velocity with respect to the Sun is just about the same as Earth's velocity with respect to the Sun, which means it has that 1 year period. So in 1 year, it's going to come right back to the Earth and it's going to do its first gravity assist. So as we said before, on the top right here is Lucy's velocity vector with respect to Earth. And as we already known, we should expect that the velocity, the magnitude of the velocity of Lucy with respect to Earth before and after the flyby should be equal since angular momentum and energy are conserved. But with respect to the Sun, it's using Earth's velocity vector and actually gaining about 5 kilometers per second. So it goes from around 30 kilometers per second around the Sun to around 35 kilometers per second around the Sun, which leads to the second flyby, which on the second flyby, basically, when Lucy gains around 5 kilometers per second, it puts it in a more elliptical orbit around the Sun. And then it's going to come back, I think, roughly 2 years later in a different location. And then this is the second Earth gravity assist, where again, the magnitude of Lucy with respect to Earth is equal before and after. But with respect to the Sun, it gains around 4 kilometers per second. And the last gravity assist actually doesn't, so this is interesting, Lucy's velocity vector does not increase in magnitude for the last gravity assist. It's more so for an inclination change, where in orbital mechanics, if you want to change the inclination of your orbit, that's actually a really costly maneuver. It's one of the more costly ones. So you want to avoid that if possible. So in this case, Lucy uses Earth to rotate its orbital plane. And we can see that here on the top, where we can see the blue is a Z component of Lucy's velocity vector. It goes from positive all the way down to negative during that flyby, which is why we see here Lucy, if you can see it very well, is now inclined with respect to the planet because it's going for this asteroid system called Patroclus, which has a different inclination with respect to all the other ones and needs that inclination change in order to do that rendezvous with Patroclus. Okay, so after all that, let's see what we're doing on time. Okay, so after all that, with all this V infinity matching, all of that assumed that we knew which planets were going to fly by. So in the first example, we just said we're going to go Earth, Venus, Mars, Earth. And Lucy, in this case, as I explained it, it's just that we know Lucy's going to do Earth, 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 gravity assist, but we don't actually know that because when you're actually given mission requirements, it's more so like, we want to go to Neptune, or in this case, we want to go to Saturn in, say, the 2040s. We have this much fuel that we can use and we have this maximum amount of time that we want to take to get there. Say we want to take less than 13 years to get to Saturn in the time of flight, and we have a certain amount of radiation dosage that the spacecraft can withstand before getting to Saturn. And then it's a job of the mission designer to then design that trajectory just given those requirements. So you don't know precisely where you're going to fly by, and you kind of have to try everything, which is where we get into graph theory, because basically, if you think about all the different combinations that you can do around the solar system of all the flybys, there's billions of combinations that you can do. It might not seem that way initially, but we'll get in another plot in this where we can show that it actually goes past the billions if you don't constrain the problem at all. So this is kind of why we use graph theory in this case. So we'll get into these diagrams in a second, but basically here is what, if you want to do an Earth to Saturn mission, this is what the tree is going to look like. So you can start going from Venus. So you go Earth, Venus, Earth, Earth, Mars, Saturn, or you could do Earth, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. But of course, this doesn't seem like billions. But the thing is, when you, this grows exponentially, because this Earth to Venus could be, say, I want to try 100 different days that I can leave from Earth and reach Venus. And then once I reach Venus, I want to try 100 different days where I can reach Earth. Once I reach Earth, I want to try 100 different days where I can reach Earth again. And that grows exponentially, as we'll see. So basically, as I just explained in the previous slide, this is basically what a tree would look like doing an Earth to Saturn mission, where you can create all the branches possible of all the flybys that you want to do. And then for this case, I'm just constraining it to 5 flybys total, as you can do, again, just to constrain the problem, because you'll see kind of why that is. So we can initially just create a really big tree that says, okay, from Earth, so starting at the top is Earth, give me 100 different trajectories that do an Earth flyby. So that's this blue section. From Earth, give me 100 other trajectories that go to Venus, 100 others that go to Mars, and 100 others that go to Jupiter. And then once you say for the Jupiter ones, okay, once you've reached Jupiter, you don't really want to do any other flybys of any other planets. So once you've reached Jupiter, just go straight to Saturn. And then for the Mars flyby, so say from Earth to Mars, let's try some that go to Jupiter and then Saturn, and then let's try some that are just Earth, Mars, Saturn. And then we can also try some that are just straight Earth to Saturn, and then all the other combinations. So we can do an Earth, 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 Jupiter, Saturn, or we can do an Earth, Jupiter, Saturn. We can do all those combinations. But the thing is that this tree is not nearly broad enough, because of the fact that for each outgoing trajectory that you have from Earth, you have one arriving trajectory that's going to Saturn, which is a linearly growing tree, which is not nearly enough because of, as we've already gone over, Lambert's problem itself has multiple solutions depending on the solver that you use. So that itself should sprout, say, 3 more nodes. Plus, this doesn't take into account that when you have this mission, you have delta V requirements. So you can do trajectory correction maneuvers that will again create more nodes. And then you can do powered flybys where you kind of help yourself. You do a burn while you're doing the flyby, which again will give you more nodes. So realistically, each node should be spawning a lot more nodes, which is again is an exponential problem. So as we said here, the number of nodes grow exponentially, and it's proportional to the number of nodes per leg. So the amount of nodes that each node will generate at the next step, to the power of the number of flybys, which is basically how many layers of tree that you have. And this grows pretty uncontrollably, because say for n equals 5 here, for 5 flybys, if you do 100 different combinations, so each node is going to sprout 100 more nodes. With 5 flybys, you're going to get 10 to the 10 different nodes, which is, say, 10 to the 6 is a million, and 10 to the 9th is a billion. So about 10 billion different combinations. You're gonna have a tree with 10 billion nodes, which is gonna get way too fast, way too quickly, because say you wanna do 300 and you wanna do 9 flybys, that's 10 to the 22. So this problem goes pretty out of control really fast. So we have to find some way to constrain the problem. Let's see what is going on. I have to get to this pretty quickly. So when we have this graph, basically what we see is just, again, these millions of nodes, but we can go back to the simpler form of just doing this here. And there's different methods of traversing a tree or searching through a tree, as is shown in graph theory. So one application is depth first, where you go, so let's try every combination of Earth, Venus, Earth, Earth, Mars, Saturn. Then we go Earth, Venus, Earth, Earth, Jupiter, Saturn, so on and so forth. So you go all the way down the tree, all the way to Saturn each time. And there's also breadth search first, where you look at all the neighbors of your current node first, and then you go to the next level and next level. So here, We start from Earth. We just do Earth to Venus, Earth to Earth, Earth to Mars, Earth to Jupiter, Earth to Saturn. We evaluate all those, and then we do the next level of the tree, Venus, Earth, Venus, Mars, Venus, Jupiter, so on and so forth. And in this case, we're going to choose breadth first. It's not immediately obvious why, but for these depth search algorithms, when we plot out an entire tree full of billions of nodes, this is just going to take forever. And there's going to be a lot of repeat information that you find. Let's say when we launch from Earth and reach Venus in 100 days, starting on, say, March 2023, and then we also launch from Earth going to Venus in March 15th, 2023, they're actually pretty much the same. So this information for a bunch of different tries of Venus is going to give you the same thing, which is kind of a big waste of time. So it makes more sense to do a breadth first search, because at each level of the breadth first search, you can do kind of a pruning of the data. So as I said, if we see that it doesn't really matter if we launch to Venus at any time, say within March 2023, we can just choose one. And then we've eliminated say 30 different branches, and 30 branches at the Venus level, at the first level, could mean say 100,000 branches later on, or 100,000 nodes later on. So that's going to save you a lot of time as far as which ones you actually want to calculate and which ones are useful. And basically the way that you want to choose how to do this first breadth level search is by, say, you can have a pretty good idea of when is a good time to launch different planets by synodic periods and by using pork chop plots. So for example, the Mars 2020 mission, what they did is they launched July 30th, 2020. So in a pork chop plot, I'm getting a little low on time here, so I'm just going to kind of quickly go through this. On a pork chop plot, it's 30 days past July 30th, and then it arrived about 120-ish days after it left, which is a local minimum of this pork chop plot, which basically what it is a bunch of different tries of Lambert's problem by brute force. So what this says is basically on July 1st, we're leaving Earth, and then say on November 1st, we're arriving at Mars, calculate that Lambert's problem, and the same thing for this 2D grid of every possible combination, and then give the delta V values for that. And you can get a pretty good idea of where a minimum is going to be by looking at a pork chop plot. And that's exactly what the Mars 2020 spacecraft use. And we can find synodic periods. So basically there's a launch window from Earth to Mars every, say, 780 days. And we can also see that from a pork chop plot with these two sections. Everything else is empty in between because these are not good times to launch from Earth and get to Mars. So there's a bunch of different ways to constrain this breadth first search, which is first by there's launch specific constraints. So your rocket can only give you so much energy away from the Earth, and it just depends on your mission and which rocket you're going to use. So after doing the breadth first search, say from the Earth to Saturn, we see that with our rocket, there's no possible launch date that could get us there just direct to Saturn. So we can actually eliminate that entire branch, which eliminates a bunch of nodes. So that's good for us. We can have a single leg constraint. So there's a minimum flyby altitude that you want to fly by. If you go too close to the planet, say like Jupiter, there's a huge radiation field. So you're going to get a huge amount of radiation doses, which is not good. Or there's too much delta V that's required in order to perform this gravity assist at this date and time. There's total path constraints. So the total amount of time, say you're doing Earth, 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 Jupiter, Saturn, but then when you get to Jupiter, you see, okay, I've already reached, say, the 10-year limit of the time of flight. We can kill that branch. So then we, again, eliminate a bunch of nodes. And then, as we said earlier, we can group a bunch of similar trajectories together. And then just as an example, Europa Clipper, which is hopefully launching, I think 2022, has two proposed trajectories. One is a direct transfer from Earth to Jupiter, which is about 2.5 years. And one is an EVGA trajectory, which is Earth, Venus, Earth, Earth, gravity assist trajectory, which would take 7.5 years, where obviously this is 5 years difference, but I'm sure they can take a lot more mass because there's less delta V on this one. So from here, actually, why don't we just go to questions, because I'm running low on time here, and the rest is just kind of bonus slides that I have planned. So if you have questions lined up, I'm not in the YouTube slides.
This is so cool. I feel like I could listen to you talk about this forever. This is so rad. Great. Well, if anybody has any questions, feel free to type them in the chat as well.
Oh yeah, that's not on YouTube. I mean, yeah, I do have, I mean, just some extra stuff if we want to, but I mean, this is kind of just extra kind of software that we have at our company.
If you'd like to continue, we can just wait until questions pop up.
Okay. Yeah. If anyone has a question, I mean, I'm looking at the chat right now, so just go ahead and post it. But basically, So when you, this is a highly parallelized search, because if we go back to the tree, for actually what I'm going to talk about, is about the company that I work for, so we can get to that. So when you're kind of searching through this tree, when you have millions of different nodes, this is all parallelizable because of the fact that the calculation of one trajectory has no effect on the calculation of another trajectory within the same level. So you could say, if you have a computer that has 50 cores, you could calculate 50 different Earth trajectories at the same time, and then 50 different Venus trajectories at the same time, and all that, and kind of just use more computing power because, again, the trajectories are not related to each other. They don't affect each other. So basically, the SPICE software that I talked about earlier from JPL, it's very useful and I use it every day at work, but it wasn't built in with kind of thread safety in mind, where you have a bunch of different parallel processes using the same piece of software and the same piece of data. So some software that I didn't develop it, my boss Juan did at Nabla Zero Labs, he developed what's called this fast ephemeris calculations, which basically, again, as I said, the way that the data is stored, it's in a binary format where you can have the polynomials of each of the Chebyshev. So each of the Chebyshev polynomials are stored in memory just as the first polynomial, second polynomial, third polynomial, so on for the position of the X, then position of the Y, the position of the Z. But kind of what he developed was another system that just says, align this data in memory such that all of the first order polynomials are next to each other, all the second order polynomials are next to each other, so on and so forth. And then kind of using basically the single instruction multiple data kind of architecture, what you can do is for a single computer instruction, so instead of just add two numbers in memory, that's a single computer instruction, there's modern architectures that can do multiple pieces of memory at the same time with the same computer instruction. So when these are lined up, you have some variables, you have say 6 floating point numbers or double precision numbers that are being held in memory, and then add all these A zeros to that in one instruction that is part of the polynomial. And then another part to that is a fuse multiply add, which is again part of modern architectures for computers, where you can do a multiply and an add in one instruction, which is exactly what polynomial addition is doing. So you can do an A times B plus C, three pieces of memory, and store it in another piece of memory all in one instruction, which all of those put together give about 20 to 100x performance increase for these ephemeris calculations, and you can do them in parallel safely. So that's kind of another piece of the software that's added to this problem in order to kind of decrease the runtime, because again, you're trying millions and millions of different combinations. So for the questions, the company, Nabla Zero Labs, right now it's just me and the CEO. I started working right after I graduated about a year ago, you know, mid pandemic. So I've been working remote. I lived in Seattle and I just moved to LA. And this is basically all we do is we just trajectory design, trajectory optimization, kind of this type of work. No, it is not the same as electrical simulation. SPICE stands for I forget. If you just look up NASA SPICE system, you'll find what it is. Modern architectures, I mean, modern CPUs. This isn't on GPUs. I'm sure there's ways, I believe artificial intelligence, when you're doing machine learning, use GPUs. But I think this is all CPU based, if I remember correctly. Missions that I've worked on, well, specifically, I'll say at Nabla Zero Labs, specifically my boss has worked on, when he worked at JPL, he worked on Europa Clipper, designing those trajectories that we saw. And then we also saw, he also worked on doing a Cassini trajectory correction maneuvers, as is already around Jupiter. And then for me, I started out Planetary Resources a long time ago, worked on some LEO missions, and then one, unfortunately, it never launched because Planetary Resources ran out of money, but I was working on one asteroid mission that was basically, I was doing the modeling and simulation for the ejecta trajectories. So basically the plan was to go to this asteroid, kind of shoot a prospector at the asteroid, have it embed in the surface and take samples of the asteroid. But then when you shoot that at the asteroid, a bunch of dust and rocks come up, which then have their own trajectories around the asteroid, which could be dangerous to the spacecraft itself because it could hit the spacecraft, or a little piece of dust could get on a lens, which could totally block out your lens, which is a pretty big problem. And I did one internship doing rocket trajectory simulations at a place in Santa Maria, California. And then I did an internship at GomSpace Luxembourg. And then I did another internship at another small startup company, San Luis Obispo, because I went to school in Cal Poly. Someone knows Planetary Resources. Yeah, they actually have a company in Seattle called First Mode, which is started by a bunch of people who were at Planetary Resources when they ran out of money, and they kind of just got all together and started a company, which they're doing really cool stuff.
Nice, that's rad. Thank you so much for sharing.
Yeah, of course. This is fun to talk about. It's just, you know, a lot of math, and I was definitely super surprised when I started this job. It's just like, it's like all math. It's all math and it's all software and it's all like interesting types of math and different.
Math is the language of the universe. And yeah. I can tell that you really like it.
Yeah, it's just interesting. Yeah, space math. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that's pretty much all I have. Yeah, I think that was the end of the presentation there. So yeah.
Well, cool. Thank you so much for your time and for hanging out with us today. It was so cool to hear your brain dump about gravity assists. I'd always been wondering, but this was like, oh, your presentation was like chock full of cool graphs, and I've never heard of a pork chop plot. That's a good one.
Oh, yeah. They're interesting to look at. They're very confusing at first. They don't really make any sense, but yeah.
I liked it. It was nice. And I like pork chops, so it works out. Well, great. Again, thank you for your time. Thanks for joining us. We got two more speakers coming up at 2:00. I've put the links in the chat. We've got McKenna Young and we've got Dr. Nicholas Lee. Please feel free to tune in if you like, and we'll see y'all there. Bye, Alfonso. Talk to you soon.